turn to the front of your hymnal or the reading of Psalm 96, we read that together in unison. Psalm 96 in front of our hymnal. Together, oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the people are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory through his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Yes, the earth is established and shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad, let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merry Christmas.
Can I have the children come up? Any children want to come up for the children's message? Come up right in here, and we're going to talk about, wow, this is a great crowd. Come right over here. This is great. Well, Merry Christmas to all you children. You're all either out of school now, or you're not in school yet, right? And you're waiting for who to come tonight?
Santa!
That's right. Santa Claus. And you know what? We had Santa here, what was it, last Saturday, I think? And he talked about the birth of Christ. Santa Claus believes in Jesus. How about that? I don't know how many children knows about that. But yeah, he believes in Jesus. And when are you going to be, you open up your gifts on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day?
Christmas Day.
Christmas Day? Christmas Eve. We used to open up ours on Christmas Eve, and it was all closed. Yeah. Because there was five of us in the family, and we always got seven gifts. One from each child, sibling, and one from my mom and dad. So we had to get all those gifts out of there for Santa Claus to bring the toys. Yeah, that's cool, huh? Yeah, that's cool. But I got three gifts here. Now sometimes, what do you open first, the big ones or the small ones?
Big ones.
You open up the small ones, huh? Well, I got three of them here, the different sizes. You can't keep any of them, but you say you like the small one? Okay, here. Don't open it yet. Okay, I'll let you get that one, you get that one. Now you can open them up, and let's see what you got. What did you get? Show the congregation what you got. You could show them. You got candy. What did you get? The baby Jesus. Now, who got the greatest gift of all? Hey, but you know, that is not, what can we do with the baby Jesus if we don't have a manger set? Put the baby Jesus down and let's build a manger set. You take that one. Be careful that you don't want to drop them. Take them out of the bag. Here, take it. And you kids are going to build a manger set up here on the table. Okay, turn them around so the congregation can see. That's a wise man. Okay, when you put your pieces down, step back so the other kids can put their pieces down. Okay. Come on, step back over here. Put the bag down now. And let's let the congregation see the manger that you put up. We have a shepherd. He was the first one that the angel called that the baby Jesus was born. And then we got the wise men. Of course, Mary and Joseph's up there. And the wise men is they came from the west all the way to the east. Now, how far is that? How long do you think it took them to go that far? How about months? It took them 3 months to go from the west, all the way from the west to the east. Is that right, Pastor?
It sounds good.
Okay. So it took them a long time because they had to go by camel. They didn't have cars or airplanes or trains or scooters or anything like that. They had to go by camel. So it took them a long time. But this is your manger set. So, well, he wasn't in the house. He was in the stable. A stable was where all the animals were kept. For the inn, like, they kept the donkeys in there, they kept the sheep in there, they kept the horses in there, camels, and that's where our Lord Savior was born. In the stable. Yeah. And, you know, at Christmas time or at on Jesus' birthday, we always give him gifts. He gives us the greatest gift of all, the gift of salvation. When he came and he was born and he was raised a baby, raised up into a child like you, and then he went to the cross to die for all of our sins. So let's all turn towards the congregation, and we're going to sing Away in the Manger, and we're going to let the children sing the first verse, and then we will go into the second and third verses. We all know the first verse, Away in the Manger.
Jesus fell down from the sky and saved.
prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, on this Christmas time, we thank you for your birth. Like the wise men, we offer you gifts of the love of our hearts. Like the shepherd, we come before you and bow in worship. Help me to love you. Always love me. Amen. Turn around and say Merry Christmas real loud.
Merry Christmas!
Okay, let's give them a hand.
Today's first lesson is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 7, verses 10 to 14. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of men? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's second lesson is from the book of 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 17. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
St. Luke chapter 2, where recorded the birth of Jesus and the message to the shepherds by the angels. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord showed around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. And when they had seen him, they spread word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We will all speak the Christmas creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, who sent his Son as my Savior on Christmas Day. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, announced by the angels, worshipped by the shepherds, adored by the wise men, who lived to suffer and die and rise again, to free us from sin, death, and the power of the devil. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who has brought me to faith in the Christ of Christmas, and by whose continuous work in my heart, I am ever led to lie before the feet of Christ as treasures of my love, and live under him as my King, both now and forevermore. Amen. Please turn and share the peace with one another.
My name is John the Baptist. Now, what is John the Baptist doing here on a Christmas Eve? You think of John the Baptist, you think of the one by the river, Jordan River, with a hell and brimstone fire message. But I'm a relative of Jesus. I grew up with Jesus. He grew up in Nazareth, about 60 miles north of Jerusalem, where I hanged out. And as you know from the last couple of Wednesday services, as we got to meet my mom, Elizabeth, and my dad, Zachariah, my dad was a priest, a pastor of the time in the temple there. And there he was, and we lived in the temple. As you brought sacrifice for your sins, that was part of our offering. That was part of our meal. As we Levites, coming from Aaron, the son of Moses, back many years ago, we took care of the synagogue, the church back then. But you know, I never liked the city life. I didn't really like the temple that much. In fact, I love the outdoors. You've heard me. You've heard my story, how much I love locusts. I think today you probably have chocolate locusts in this community. I love being free and being out there and roaming around in the desert and in the river and the water. It was God's country to me. It was incredible. Because I saw in the city life of my dad and the frustration of people just got used of doing the same old thing. Bringing their offerings to the synagogue, to the temple, learning in the synagogues of their towns. But did they really take it serious? No, they would eat, drink, and be merry during the week, and then Sunday come, and once again that Saturday or Sabbath, they'd come and bring their forgiveness, and then do it all over again. And then some didn't even go to the synagogues anymore. They gave up on God, and they would do their own thing. Well, the Holy Spirit led me in the desert. There's something about the desert or the countryside. To get away from the city and to go out and just get away from all that external stuff that we get so bogged down and so worried and concerned from day to day. Being out in the country, you don't have those worries anymore. You live off the land. You have more time to think and talk and to God and discuss with God and even argue with God. And that Holy Spirit led me to start being the priest in the desert, encouraging people to wake up, for the kingdom of God is near. No, not the end times, as you just, some of you celebrate this past Friday. The kingdom of God is the Messiah has finally come. And it was my cousin Jesus. I remember those days. We didn't get to see a lot of Jesus. But he had come on Passover when we came 12 years of age, and he'd come to the temple, and I were the same age, and so for a couple years we hanged out, and I was kind of just a bully, and he was gentle, kind, compassionate. But as I was led in the desert to wake up the people, like the tax collectors, man, don't cheat, or the Roman soldiers, don't abuse, or the Pharisees, don't be a hypocrite, or to the common people, just go back to the Ten Commandments and to share. And that day when Jesus came after to be baptized, I was floored. I knew there was something special about him. When he came, the Holy Spirit, just when I was in my mother's womb 30 years before, leaped for joy. I wept for joy because the Holy Spirit says, he is the Messiah. Boy, what a joy that was for me that day. And then he was off and he started doing his ministry and do some wonderful things. This baby grew up, this teenager grew up, this adult now was sharing the love of God. And I tell the people, you better watch out for this Messiah because he's going to come with fire and a willing fork and he's going to thrash us to get us back on the game plan. Boy, was I shocked when I didn't see any fire from Jesus. He was kind and gentle and loving and forgiving. I was shocked when I didn't see an army raise up to get the people waking up, especially those Pharisees. And then I had my doubts when I too was arrested. Remember the Herod that went after Jesus when he was small? Well, his relative. His son went after me when I caught him in a sin, when he killed his own brother. Evil, pure evil. And I said that was wrong, and I was thrown into a dungeon. You know what a dungeon is like? When you lived out in the countryside all your life, you had the freedom to do whatever you want. All of a sudden, you're in a cage, and you're trapped. What? Where is this Messiah? I started having doubts. I sent my guys over to Jesus and said, hey, are you really the one? Where's the army? Where's the fire? Where's the rescue team to get me out of this cage? And he came, his words came back. You know what he said to my disciples? Look around you. Look what's happening. I am over any illness that comes your way. I'm over any evil spirits that conquer our hearts and minds, I even am greater than death itself. And then it hit me. I remember those words. When he first came to be baptized, I told the disciples, the Holy Spirit said, look, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Unfortunately, I was thinking of my own little world. But Jesus came to this earth. He had roamed freedom of the universe, and he came to be in a cage on earth for you and I. He came to go through fire that was meant for us. And he became a cage sinner so we could be freed. Your pastor tells a story. We went to college, about his roommate Greg. Greg went to school full time, plus he worked at a gas station full time, and he was stressed out. Middle of the night, one night, all of a sudden, Pastor Tim heard his roommate yelling and crying in the next room. And when he got to the next room, middle of the night, there his roommate was crawled behind a chair, holding on. And when he woke up Greg, he asked him what was going on. And Greg says, I was trapped in a gas pump, and I couldn't get out. How many of us are trapped tonight, whether physically or emotionally or financially or in relationships or health or whatever it is, that we are caged because of sin and death and evil and Satan? But that's why this baby came. And that's why we encourage you tonight, don't let this baby Jesus stay in the manger in your lives. Whether you come to church every Sunday or you come whenever you are drawn to, that every day this child rises up to be your Savior and to help you have that peace no matter what cage you're in. That's what we love about Romans. Listen to Romans chapter 8. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall trouble or hardships or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither present nor the future, or any powers of height or depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. What is your cage tonight? And tonight we celebrate. Emmanuel has come, which means God is with us in that cage. And he'll guide us. And he'll give us the strength and the peace to be content, because we all will be released one day to be with him and his Father forever in God's real country, eternal life, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening and Merry Christmas to all. Our Christmas prayer this evening is, oh God, you make this most holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that as we have known the mysteries of that light on earth, we may also come to the fullness of his joys in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now we will all say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
As we just heard John the Baptist tell us, sin ran rampant in his days, just as sin runs rampant today with us. But then he also told us about that Savior that he was announcing that takes away all those sins. And it becomes really simple for us then. We just have to come to that Savior, confess our sins, and ask for His forgiveness. So now, let's take a few minutes of our time to remember those sins which we have done in the past, and especially this past week, and pray for God's forgiveness. In the mercy of the Almighty God, He gave this little baby, Jesus Christ, to die for us. And for His sake, our God then forgives us all our sins. And all we need to do is believe on this Jesus Christ. And He gives us the power to become children of His Heavenly Father. He bestows on us His Holy Spirit to help us through our life. And so may this Lord that has begun this good work in us bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ as we celebrate His birth. In Jesus Christ, amen. We now are ready to commence with our communion, partake of our Holy Communion. If you read the portion in there, we are in the Lutheran Church here. We believe in the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in with and under this bread and wine. We ask you, if you believe the same as we do, you're welcome to partake of Holy Communion at our Lord's table. If you do not desire to take of communion, please come up with us and receive with the rest and receive the Lord's blessings. Just keep your hands folded and we'll give you a blessing. We will have two lines coming up the middle and be serving communion on both sides. This side will be over here. This side will be over here. And please, come to your Lord with a fervent and reverent heart and receive His blessing or His communion. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night in which He was betrayed, He took bread. And when He had broke it, He gave it to His disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is My body, which is given to you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you eat it in remembrance of Me." And after that same manner also, He took the cup after supper. When He had given thanks, He gave it to them and He said, "Drink ye all of it. This is the true blood of My body, given to you for the forgiveness of all your sins. As often as you drink this blood in remembrance of Me." And may the peace of the Lord be with you as you come to His holy table. And now, having received this wonderful blessing of our blessed Savior's body and blood, take with you. Go in His peace, knowing that your sins are forgiven through that precious Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
While you were sleeping, shivers in the cold, trying to keep the Savior warm. Born among the animals, wrapped in dirty rags because there was no room for him in the world he came to save. Oh, Bethlehem, would you have missed while you were sleeping? Oh, God became a man and stepped into your world today. Oh, Bethlehem, you will go down in history as a city with no room for its king while you were sleeping. While you were sleeping. United States of America looks like another silent night. As we're sung to sleep by philosophies that save the trees and kill the children. Eastern sky. For the bridegroom has returned and has carried his bride away in the night. In the night. America, what will we miss while we are sleeping? Would Jesus come again and leave us slumbering where we lay? America, will we go down in history as a nation with no room for its king? Will we be sleeping? Will we be sleeping? United States of America looks like another silent night.
raise your candle up a little bit higher and turn around, and you can see all the lights around you. Pretty powerful, isn't it? It's really cool looking to see the lights. There's a powerful story in our last hurricane in the East Coast about a neighbor trying to get across the street to the other neighbor. As he crossed the street in the flooding water, all of a sudden a tidal wave about 7 foot came down his street. He grabbed onto a tree and climbed the branches and hung on to dear life as the neighbor that he was going to watch from the window. Both of them had, the neighbor who was hung into the tree had a little pin light. And so he starts shining the pin light to his neighbor in the window, and his neighbor got a flashlight. And throughout the night, they kept shining their lights towards each other. Until that morning, the rescue team could rescue the neighbor from the tree. This is what we're all about, believers of the birth of Jesus Christ and the Savior who rose from the dead, is that life is difficult. We live in the darkness, but we have a great light that shines in our hearts, and that's the hope and the comfort and the fact that Christ loved you and has rescued you from your past, has given you an incredible future to shine your faith and light in the dark to each other. Be that light this Christmas and through the new year. Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
God's blessings. Lord is peace. Amen. Once you're finished with your light, please blow it out. The lights will turn on now, and God's blessings. We have a gift for every child as you leave. There's a little gift. Make sure you get it in the back as you leave. Lord is peace.